When I first met Ray Gosling, it was after the 2010 riots. I wanted to hear what he had to say about it all, given he'd been around St. Anne's during the race riots of 1958. That night, more than 1,000 people went on the rampage, with many stabbings. The Evening Post described the area as a slaughterhouse. A few days later, it kicked off in Notting Hill, and the media swiftly focused their attentions on the more important story happening in the capital. As we chat about this, Ray is winding up his watch. I get the impression I'm on a timer, and if I'm not interesting enough, he'll be off. But as I will learn over the course of this 3-year interview, he just likes winding things up. The riots of August 2011 were very different to 58. This time, blacks and whites went on the assault together. 5 police stations were firebombed. One was in St. Anne's, a place close to Ray's heart. These protests seemed senseless in comparison, having no common goal. For most, it was just an opportunity to vent. Yet this attitude was also prevalent in 1958, though is perhaps less remembered. A week after the riots, 4,000 youths descended on St. Anne's, but with no visible black faces to attack, they turned on each other. "It's a rough old town. I absolutely love it," says Ray, stamping his fist down on the table. So what did he make of the riots and the protests against the cuts? "I've met 2 of the looters already. I'll tell you what could help. If John Collins said he'd give up 10,000 quid of his 82,000 a year if everyone is having cutbacks. Don't ask for it to come from the bottom. Why do you think the castle was burned down in 1831? Because the same thing was in kids then. I met these 2 almost dysfunctional, incoherent rioters. They didn't know why they'd done it in coherent terms. I knew why they'd done it. You can't live in a society where the Duke of Newcastle lives." There are long pauses during the conversation as he ponders, trying to recall facts. At other times, he simply needs to catch his breath. I roll up a cigarette and I'm quickly told, "Stop trying to make out you're working class." He is distracted by anyone that walks past, wanting to know about their shoes, the book they're reading, where their accent is from. It's like he's still making his documentaries. And boy, he made a few of them. Gosling is more experienced at being the interviewer, and so our roles change throughout our meetings. His mood swings are equally unpredictable, flitting between screams, tears, and a laughter that rattles in the jaws. He tells how he left Northampton for Leicester because it was a bigger city, home of the first Tesco's outside of London, a drive-in post office and bank, as well as the first automatic multi-storey car park in Europe. These observations were recorded in his first documentary, Two Town Mad, in 1963, a kind of psychogeography of the East Midlands. Ray went to university in Leicester. "It used to be a mental home," he laughed. "I couldn't bear it. I really liked the lecturers and became friends with them, but I couldn't stand the other students. They all had ideas of wanting to get on. I didn't have ideas like that at all. I wanted a life." Ray has planned on writing his memoirs for a few years now, but never quite gets round to doing it. "Life is for living, not for writing," he says. But life is also for drinking, and he's knocked back his fair share over the years. "I've been drinking since I was 12. I drink brandy and wine now. In those days, I drank 10 pints a night. There were 50 pubs in my St. Anne's. I'd have a drink in every one." I raise an eyebrow. "Not every night." He dropped out of university and started up rock and roll dances instead. "We did this club and it was wonderful for 2 years, 24 hours a day. You can't imagine a youth club open for 24 hours a day." The club would eventually close down due to gang trouble and fighting. "Were people more violent then?" "No," he exclaims. "There's always been a bit of violence and there's always been a bit of trouble. I absolutely love the world as it is now. I'm enormously proud of how kids have come on." Nottingham became a temporary refuge from the troubles and would become his eventual home. He would take up the cause of the St. Anne's Residents and Tenants Association, and spend 15 years fighting city planners who threatened to flatten the 340 acres that was home to 30,000 people and 500 shops. He argued for selective demolition and simple improvements for the better parts to make it a more livable place. This was the beginning of new urbanism, but without the trendy label. During a snowy weekend in February 1967, 15,000 leaflets were posted to residents. Despite only two replies from those with what Ray called leadership material, the movement began to gain momentum and was later helped by the publication of Ken Coates' book, Poverty, The Forgotten Englishman. I think people made a lot of money about books on poverty in those days, Ray scoffs, though this is only because he wants any credit to stay with the community. All we wanted was ever so simple things like a pedestrian crossing, an adventure playground, the allotments. Now it's commonplace, but it wasn't back then. When I ask how the leaflet shoot was funded, he becomes irate. Money is always the easiest thing. Courage is the difficult thing to find. He begins to well up. He doesn't want to talk about the places he saved. He can only see the battles he's lost. It still hurts. I ask whether he's optimistic about the future, suggesting the internet has made it easier for interest groups to mobilise and disseminate information. He tells me, not for the first time, that I'm talking absolute rubbish. There was a greater sense of solidarity when you had to be very close to people, he says. You had to be drinking with people, sharing space with people, living in tiny rooms with people. It's never been the same since they altered the pattern of the streets. There's truth in this. His close friend Alan Silito described it in that book. The maze of streets, sleeping between Topaka Factory and Bicycle Factory, drew them into the enormous spread of its suburban bosom and embraced them in sympathetic darkness. But Gosling's fondness for nostalgia makes him overly dismissive of modernity. Though he is right about the internet, immediacy shouldn't be confused with intimacy. I try a different tact, mentioning the good done by local organisations like the Sumac Centre. But I'm wrong again. Absolutely wrong, he tells me. The Sumac Centre is a specialist centre. What I'm talking about is an ordinary place, like pubs. That's what has gone from our lives. There's only one pub left in our city centre, and that's the Dog and Partridge. It belongs to the whole of the people. Anybody can go in. Yobs can go in. But it's for these very reasons that it's not for the whole of people. In our drinking sessions together, Gosling bemoans the death of the British pub, oblivious to the fact that people leave when he starts shouting about it. I don't point this out and instead return back to collective action, asking whether he ever visited the Mushroom Bookshop. Oh dear, he says. I've got to be very careful about this. I've always found those trendy, lefty things, some of which I've worked for and they've paid me money, some I've worked for and they haven't paid me any money. I've always found them a bit of a club for people who all think alike. The Radical Bookshop wasn't radical enough with its orderly shelves and helpful staff. I'm an anarchist, he points out. Not in the sense of throwing bombs at people. That's got nothing to do with anarchy at all. I'm very suspicious of all governments, and I want people to be free. It's very simple. He was once asked to give a talk on anarchy to university students at the Bell Hotel, and was thrown out halfway through due to his foul language and what could politely be described as nonconformist behaviour. The next time we meet up, I place my dictaphone on the table. He shakes his head. Tony Wedgwood Benn records everything when he's being interviewed to make sure nobody can misquote him. I guess you get paranoid when you're a politician, especially when you're Tony Wedgwood Benn. He laughs. I've been given a subtle warning. He says he's been up St Anne's since we last spoke, that the public space is an absolute disgrace. John Collins has been sent a letter. I suggest that we're living in times of austerity and again am reprimanded. Money has got nothing to do with it, as he explains. We used to organise our own rubbish service. We'd hire, for free, a rubbish vehicle from the city council and we'd go around ourselves clearing up the backyard rubbish. It was just a community operation. These days, of course, they nearly all get grants for things, but in my day, there wasn't really grants. There were people. This sounds dangerously like the big society, and it's not for the first time that this radical, working-class anarchist reveals himself as a old-school, pull-up-your-sleeves conservative. It's befitting of a man of his complexity to be blessed with such contradictions. He wants things run on a small scale, with minimal intervention. He laments the loss of personable politics, recounting how politicians of his day worked day jobs, and you could swing by and ask them questions or sort out repairs. They weren't career politicians, they were ordinary blokes who could get your lights fixed. I don't ask him about the BBC euthanasia documentary, but he brings it up. Perhaps he's bored of waiting for me to ask. For those unaware, Ray admitted on a pre-recorded television documentary in 2010 that I killed someone once. He'd been my lover and he got AIDS. I picked up the pillow and smothered him until he was dead. No regrets. This caused a national scandal where he was arrested and then released when the police investigated it further and realised his story was completely made up. But there's nothing new in his account that you haven't heard already. What is more interesting is his description of the detective who interviewed him during his 2 days holed up in cells at Oxdale Police Station. Just listen to the hiss behind the sartorial compliment. The chief copper, detective, was beautifully dressed. Real Marks and Spencer suit. Bought out of Nottingham Constabulary money. We're all as bad as each other is the message. His biggest disappointment is that at this point he knew his career was coming to an end. His portraits of ordinary people were no longer in vogue and had long been replaced by the extraordinary tales told by the likes of Louis Theroux and John Ronson. During the 60s and 70s, Gosling was one of the best-known faces in television documentary programming. During his weekly slot on Granada with On Sight, he visited a different town each week, enabling members of the public to voice off their concerns at officialdom. On the radio, he offered quirky portraits of people and places in Britain. "I lived in a glorious era," he reminisces. "I could do anything and dictate the terms." You don't get that anymore. Of all the people he's met, one person stands out in particular. "We did a man in Warrington. He was an engineer. We always wanted people who were normal. He took us to his shed and said," at this point he puts on a Lancashire accent, "wife's never been in shed. Sometimes my mouth would come out of those interviews with blood because I'd been biting my lip. What have you got in there, in your shed?" I asked. "I collect stones," he said. Gosling sees me grinning and warns that you mustn't laugh at such things because this is how people are. But I'm laughing at him because he loves putting on accents. "Stones," he said. "I've got some from the Peak District, some from the Lake District." And they were all numbered, Gosling informs me. We went in the shed and it was unbelievable, like the crown jewels. If my office was like his office, I'd be magnificent. He catalogued it all on his computer, all done properly. He had a story about them all. He begins to laugh. Gosling has won numerous awards for such programmes. His documentary, Ray Gosling OAP, won a Jonathan Gilley Award in 2007, beating off The Apprentice to win Most Entertaining Documentary. His film on Joe Orton was part of a programme which won the RTS Midlands Best Regional Programme in 2008. When I ask him where these awards are, he shrugs his shoulder. "God knows. They're somewhere in the sty of my flat or the house in Manchester or London. I don't glory in anything like that. I'm not interested. I just love the work." "Can he remember any of the award ceremonies?" "I got pissed." When collecting an award from Princess Margaret, he was asked by, a shirt and tie, to address her as a Royal Highness. I gave him two fingers and told him to fuck off. She doesn't mind me calling her Margaret. I couldn't say your grace. I'm just a poor peasant boy. Besides, they wouldn't want you to. What makes him happiest now? This sour Midlands county that I've become very close to. People are very hard in Nottingham, he grins. It's a wonderful attitude. I ask him to be more specific. You haven't got any eyes on your dictaphone, but there's a big bloke up there. He points to the top of the bar. And I bet he ain't gonna smile. He's just gonna look. There's a real roughness about this city, and I really admire it. Later on, we experienced this when doing the photo shoot. An electrician refused to move his van to allow us to take the photograph before complaining, "This place is a shithole. What's the matter with you lot? Why the fuck would you want to take a picture of an old man sat on a manky sofa?" Gosling loves it. He asks the man where he lives, and when the man replies Loudon, Gosling nods his head. Very posh. I didn't know working class people could afford to live in Loudon. The guy instantly softens. I don't. I rent. I've got to go to Bestwood next. That's even worse. He nearly runs us over when he reverses, which Gosling treats like a peck on the cheek. Where does this roughness come from? Bloody hell, says Ray. You know where it comes from. It comes from the pits. It comes from the 18 people who died at Markham Colliery in 1973. Work. It comes from the factories. Alan Sillitoe's rally. Gosling and Sillitoe were good friends, both fighting the system in their own way. Sillitoe fought through the flat Radford vows of Arthur Seton, creating a realistic portrayal of working class life, which would take its place alongside the more familiar middle and upper class domain of literature. Gosling continued this process through the poetic realism of his broadcasting, giving voice to ordinary people about subjects that were important to them. They made a powerful double act. I miss Alan, says Ray. He was a thoroughly good bloke. Sillitoe was given the keys to the city, and perhaps now it's Gosling's turn. Today perfectly illustrates why he should be recognised. It's 17th of July, the day that same-sex marriage has been given royal assent. But typically, he doesn't even want to discuss it. I had me gay day yesterday. I don't want another, he tells me. Gosling has had quite a few gay days during his life. He was an early pioneer of the gay rights movement, working with Alan Horsfall in the 60s in what would later become the Campaign for Homosexual Equality. They set up the website Gay Monitor, detailing cases of discrimination. He opposed the controversial Section 28 legislation that banned local authorities from promoting homosexuality, which was eventually repealed on 18th of November 2003. In his home, there is a framed photograph of Lord Wolfenden, whose report on the 4th of September 1957 made the recommendation that homosexual behaviour between consenting adults in private should no longer be a criminal offence. Same-sex marriage must mean something. It's the final vindication of a lifelong struggle to justify his sexuality. But Gosling is a fighter. He needs an enemy to define himself against. Of course the judgment is important, but now there's another issue to consider. I don't like marriage, he tells me. I've never seen the point of it. He's no stranger to the political arena. I was the first person in this country to stand as a loony, which I did in Lenton. I think it was 63. Vote for a madman was the campaign. I got more votes than Screaming Lord Sutch ever got. This may be true of when Lord Sutch stood at Stratford-upon-Avon after the fall of Mr. Profumo, but not of the Bootle by-election in 1990, when he secured more votes than the candidate of the SDP. Within days, the SDP dissolved itself. Gosling certainly inspired Lord Sutch, who sought him out for advice way before leading the monster-raving loony party from 83 to 99. When I mention it was tragic that Sutch committed suicide, Gosling doesn't believe me. He looks hurt and confused. "You're wrong," he says. Suddenly, he looks like a frail and dishevelled old man, born in 1939. When I ask Ray who his heroes are, his memory is sharp again. He lists every single person involved in the St. Anne's Project. D.H. Lawrence was incredible too. But just because we can't all be Lawrences doesn't mean we shouldn't do our bit. Like Left Lion is doing, which the magazine I write for. But his real idol is Colin McInnes, the author who depicted London's youth and black immigrant culture during the 50s, such as in Absolute Beginners. That was the first novel of teenage times, he informs. I think I was the model for it, really. This kid who wasn't sure of anything and wanted to change the world. McInnes, a bisexual, took Gosling under his wing and lovingly nicknamed him Junior, though, as Gosling points out, we never slept with each other. He introduced him to coffee bars, jazz clubs and celebrities. He taught me how to dress. You always wear something smart and something scruffy. He shows off his Paul Smith shirt and casual trainers. He's still got it. The only problem is that he smells unwashed and there's a beer stain on his cuff. I ask if there's anyone in his life, and I'm told, it's complicated. Then he adds, you get to a certain age, and it's difficult to have a wank. He starts to smile, perhaps considering this. Or could it be the fun he had with his partner of 30 years, who passed away in 1999? Whatever the thought, he suddenly has this lovely, gentle glow about him, and it's infectious. I've had a tempestuous love life, in many ways, but then I'm an enormously emotional man. It's a quality. You take part in life, that's what you do. You mustn't be wrapped up in your own self-importance. Importance sometimes happens to you. I had that in St. Anne's, or on the radio, or the telly. Should I have been more serious, like a vicar? Nah. I've had a lovely life. I've earned money, I've spent money. The only thing I've got left is to die.